Always an honor, always a privilege, always a pleasure to talk to a living legend. Always a pleasure to have Mirko Crocop on the show, and what a great time to have him on, coming off that phenomenal run in Japan just a couple of weeks ago. He wins the Ryzen Openweight Grand Prix, and he is kind enough to join us right now on the show once again. Mirko, are you there?
I'm here.
What a pleasure. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
I'm doing great. It's good to talk to you, as always. So, again, congratulations on an amazing three-fight streak there, winning the Grand Prix, winning the tournament. It was shades of the old Mirko Crocop. It was a lot of fun for your longtime fans. And afterwards, let's get to the big stuff first. Afterwards, there was a report that came out that you said you're done. You're retiring. That's it for you. Is this true?
Yeah, it's true. It's true. Unfortunately, but it is true. There is definitely a time when you have to say enough, you know. And I had a lot of injuries, you know, and so there is no sense of training. If training creates a lot of pain and et cetera, you know. And once I said that I will train and I will fight as long as. Trainings will be pleasure for me, but under these circumstances, it's out of the question. And first of all, I need to fix my knee, which creates a lot of problem for me. And the right knee that I broke 8 years ago, and I hurt it again before this last preparation, and. I had to go for another surgery, and but of course I said, let's get something. I said it would be nice if I will be able to recover enough to have a farewell fight, maybe in Japan. It would be nice, but to tell you the truth, I don't know how the surgery will go, what kind of rehabilitation is in front of me, and I'm not sure if my knee will be good enough to for a full camp, you know. I don't know. But at the end of the day, my career is definitely, with that farewell fight or without it, I'm done. I'm done with my fighting career.
If you weren't injured, if you didn't have these health problems, would you continue fighting? Do you want to keep fighting? Deep down, you just can't anymore?
Excuse me, what did you say? I'm losing signal here.
Sorry, I said that if it wasn't for the injuries, if you were healthy and you know, you were still feeling good, would you want to keep fighting, or, you know, regardless of the injuries, you've had enough?
I don't know. It is hard to say, you know, but it's always, there will be, as long as I live, there will be a fire inside of me, you know, but there is a time when you have to say enough, you know, and for so many reasons. It's not just about the knee. Of course, it is the biggest reason, my health, and it is very important for me, you know, and I want to have a quality life after my career, and I want to keep training as long as I breathe. I will keep the trainings, you know, not so hard trainings like I had, like I used to have, but I turned 42 4 months ago, and you know, there are so many people. I have a family, you know, and this sport is a huge stress, not just for fighters, but also for fighters' family, you know. And it is not a sport like, I don't know, like basketball, like tennis, like swimming or whatever, you know. You lose the fight, okay, who cares? You lose the game, who cares, you know. And but this is MMA, you know, and sometimes, first of all, injuries might be hard. And my older son will be 14 soon, and my younger one is 6. And can you imagine, you know, how he would feel that he watched me laying down on the ground, and then when somebody's finishing me with a ground and pound straight to the head, like I did to King Mo or Ali Akbar, you know. It is hard, and this is very stressful business, you know. Mm-hmm. It's stressful business, and part of my heart will always stay inside, and there will be always fire inside of me. But there is a time when you have to say enough, you know. There is, even I feel basically, I feel good. If there is no injuries, you know, I feel good. I can't prepare. I can't prepare for even for a 10-minute rounds. And my last camp was the hardest one in my career, you know.
Oh. Really.
And I feel good. Conditioning-wise, stamina-wise, everything, recovery, everything. Everything was good, you know. But I had and I still have big problems with that knee. There is some kind of liquid, you know, that my body kind of release inside of that knee, and it gets swollen after every training. And three times a week, I had to go to the doctor, and he put a huge needle inside of my knee, and he had to take that liquid out. You know, I don't have to explain you how hard it is and how painful it is and how stressful it is. And at the end of the day, I had to take antibiotics all the time, you know, because I couldn't afford to get some infection or something, you know. It was very hard. It was, and that means it won't be better. It can't be better because I just don't have some part of it inside, you know. Meniscus was taken out completely, you know, and ligament was completely broken. They are stitched, but and now I had another injury. That's why that liquid started, and that's why I had to go for another surgery. You know, most likely I will go in 10 days or 1 week when I get back to Zagreb. I'm in my ball village, and I'm relaxing here with my family, and I have to see the doctor first, MR first, to see what kind of surgery I need, you know. And but at the end of the day, that's it, you know.
And so for someone dealing with these issues, and you said you're 42, you've been fighting for a long time, to fight three times in the span of 2 days and then twice in one night, what kind of pain were you in? What was that like?
Well, to tell you the truth, I didn't feel the pain during the fight. You know, I feel nothing.
Huh.
I feel nothing. I feel good. I don't feel any problems with my knee during the fight, you know, but before the fight, after the fight, during trainings, you know, in the morning when I wake up, it creates a lot of pain. But I got to be honest, I didn't feel nothing. I feel good, you know. I feel good during the fight.
Okay.
And I felt good. And but basically that's it, you know. That it is a huge privilege for every fighter to leave the sport as a winner. You know, there are so many champions in a combat sport, in a MMA, in kickboxing, in boxing, you know, who just didn't know when to stop, because there is always younger and stronger fighters are coming and coming and coming, and sooner or later, of course, I believe, and that many people, many fans would like to see me fighting, you know, but I think it is priceless to lead the sport as a winner, you know.
Sure.
with the belt, you know, I think it's priceless, and I believe I'm right, you know, and I'm sure that you will agree, you know. And,
so if you didn't win the final, would you have kept fighting to leave on top? Like, were you feeling a lot of pressure? Oh, I want to win this one so that I can leave with a victory?
Yeah, it's hard to say now.
Okay.
It's hard. It's easy to be a general after the battle, you know, but
yeah.
I really don't know. But it happened the way it happened, you know, and I said even in Japan, and I said when I get back to Croatia, you know, that there is one surgery in front of me, and this is the end of my career. I promise. I knew. Listen. I knew. I said two or three times already that I'm done, you know. But once a fighter, always a fighter. But definitely, I reached the end of my fighting career, you know. And there must be a line, and you will stop, you know. And this is the best way, believe me, the best way to leave the sport. As a champion, as a winner, is priceless. For me, it is priceless, you know. There are so many big champions, you know. Of course, they will always face a champion, but it just leaves kind of a bad taste in the mouth, you know, when you leave the sport at 3, 4, or 5 5 losses in a row, etc., etc. No,
mm-hmm.
This is hard for there isn't something. No one is unbeatable, you know, and everyone lost. Everyone we lost, and everybody lost the fight, you know. So, but I think it is important how you will leave the sport, you know, how you will leave the sport and etc. If I'm younger, of course, I would most likely I would think different, you know. But in age of 42, and I will be 43 in September. I mean, enough is enough, you know. Enough is enough.
What was it like fighting someone like Baruto, who's over 400 pounds?
Listen, to be honest, you know, and to be fair, Baruto was the weakest point. He's enormously strong. He's the first of all. He's very heavy, and he's a huge guy. 180 kilograms. I don't know in pounds, and 440. But he has no skills, you know. He has no skills, you know. He can be kind of a danger if he's on top of you, because you need to take off your back or off your chest the guy who is laying on you with 180 kilograms. But I wouldn't let him take me down, you know. And he was definitely he was the weakest point. But two others, Ali Akbari and the King Mo, they are really tough, and they are excellent fighters, you know.
Was it disappointing?
You know, this is business. I talked with some people in Japan. Why they put Baruto is a big star in Japan, you know.
Yeah.
And this is a business, and this is business. This is business. Same thing happens many times in UFC, you know, when you see the fighters who don't deserve a title shot, but they will say pay-per-view, and they get the title shot.
Yeah.
But they don't deserve, according to the recent results, there are many, you know, but they will get the title shot because this is business. This is business. Same thing happened with Baruto. Baruto is a huge star, very, very famous sumo fighter.
Yeah.
Japan, and people just wanted to see him, you know, and that's it.
How disappointed were you that you couldn't fight Vanderlei in this tournament? Because you posted this thing on Facebook, and it was kind of, I asked you, was this really you? Because I've never seen you write this way before. You said, don't be scared and all this stuff.
Oh, it was me. It was me. Yeah, I don't like that kind of talk, dirty talk. It's not my style, you know, but I just knew it. Believe me, I knew it. And what he did wasn't fair, you know, because he knew from the beginning that he ain't going to fight. Why he did it, why he made all that campaign, why he appeared on the press conference in September, why he started giving lessons to other fighters that he will show the way that everybody should fight, you know, I don't know. Most likely he wanted to be a tough guy in front of his fans, etc., but I can't prove it, but I'm 100% sure that he knew at that moment, he knew he will never enter the ring. Because at that time, he already promised himself that he will come as a guest for Bellator show in Italy, which is supposed to be in the middle of his preparation. Who would leave the training camp in the middle of preparation to go on another continent to get the jet lag just to appear as a guest? No one. No one, you know. No one will. But at the end of the day, I don't care, you know. I don't care. I wasn't upset later. I was happy that King Mo, who is much, much more dangerous fighter and much, 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 much tougher fighter than Vanderlei is, you know. And when I would knock Vanderlei out again, and he was aware of it. That's why he didn't show up. And what people say? Hey, Vanderlei was injured. Vanderlei didn't fight for 3 years, you know, and this is better. Believe me, this is better. And I was very happy when I get a substitute in King Mo. You know?
Yeah, I mean, King Mo's a very active fighter, credible fighter. Did it make you lose any respect for Vanderlei? I mean, I know you've had a history with him, you fought him in the past, but do you now think differently of him, considering the fact that you said you knew from the get-go that he wasn't going to show up?
I don't care. Listen, I don't care much. I don't think too much, and I don't care. To be honest, I don't care at all. You know, he doesn't exist for me. You know, not because we are not friends. You're nothing. We used to be. We used to be prize fighters before two times. You know, he was a great champion at the time. During Pride Age, you know, he was really tough. But and I wish him all the best. Nothing else. Nothing else. I don't want to think too much about him. I don't want to talk about him. I really, without pathetic, I wish him all the best. I want him to recover. If he's still really injured, maybe he is not. I don't know. But, you know, I wish him nothing but the best. That's all.
Okay. Do you leave with any regrets now? Are you, what a story to win an open weight Grand Prix 10 years after you did so in Pride. I mean, it's amazing what you were able to accomplish and go out with the victory, as you said, on your terms. Any regrets at all?
Now I have a really long and a successful career and no regrets. You know, of course, everybody would. I would like that I didn't have any of the losses I had. You know, but that's life. You know, you can't win every fight. You can't win every fight. You know, but I'm leaving as a happy man, and I'm proud. I'm very proud of my career. You know, and. And in the age of 42, I told everybody that I can prepare myself and I still can be very dangerous and very competitive, you know? And that's also important for me.
So for you, like, what do you say to people? Cause I even had people tweeting me like, oh, you spoke to him about his retirement last year and he came back. What do you say to people who say, I don't believe you, you're going to fight again. Every fighter comes back. What do you say to those people?
Yeah, listen, I said that, it would be nice if health allowed, if my health, I'm talking about my knee.
Yeah.
Because it creates right now. It would be nice if I could have a fairer fight, you know. I would like it to be announced. And it would be nice, you know. At the end of the day, I deserve it after such a long career. I deserve it. But even it can be better to go in retirement. With this Ryzen Open Grand Prix Championship, you know,
yeah.
It will depend. I really don't know how it will work with my knee. I really don't know how it will work. And am I going to be able to go through the complete training camp, you know, for a possible farewell fight? So I don't know. I don't want to push. I don't want to push. And there is of course there's always a risk that I can lose the fight, you know, And as I said before, leaving the sport as a winner, going to retirement as a winner is priceless, you know. So I have to think about it. But definitely, I won't be back. I promise. I know I said a few times, but at the end of the day, everybody's coming back, but not this time, not anymore. You know, I could say before that I was younger, but I enter 43 and. I will turn 43 in September, and you know, it sounds funny when I say it sounds funny to me when I listen to myself. But health is also very important thing. You know, mm-hmm. this is hard and tough sport, and so many punches to the head. Not in the fight. I had really bloody camp this time. So many sparring partners, really tough guys. You know. And we are exchanging punches to the head. It was really bloody sparring, you know. I had three top sparring partners, and they were changing every 2 minutes. And I was in the ring 10 minutes, you know, 10 minutes round. I was doing 10 minutes round. Even I knew I'm going to fight only 5 minutes round, but for this camp I was doing 10 minutes rounds. And every 2 minutes, young guy. One was 29. One was 26 and one was 24. And they are really tough and young, upcoming fighters, you know, and it was really bloody, you know. And I gave a lot of punches. I gave a lot of kicks. But I also received, you know. And you can't avoid it, you know. You can't avoid it. If everyone, for a round, if you get 5 punches to the head, now calculate how many rounds I did during preparation.
Yeah.
And I just have to think about myself, you know. I just have to think about my health.
What is it like for you being in Japan? I mean, I've never had the privilege of watching or covering one of your fights in Japan. When you like, can you walk the streets? How do the people receive you there? Because you've meant so much to that part of the world. You became so famous fighting in Japan. What is it like for you to go back there and fight in front of those fans?
It's a great feeling. It's a great thing for me to fight in Japan. And as I said many times, Japan is my second homeland, and I started my career there. And I believe the Japanese likes me a lot, you know. And you're right. Many of them, I can't say everybody, especially older people or kids, you know, but many people recognize them on the street, and they approach me, they're asking for autograph or photo, etc. You know?
Yeah, I bet. I know they're very appreciative of you. And so what are you going to do now, Mirko? Like, what are you going to do for the rest of your life? What's your plan?
Well, I don't know. And That's a good question. I will stay in the sport, definitely.
Okay.
Through my own training, because it makes me so happy, and that's my way of living. I can't imagine a day without training, you know. And I just finished my workout half an hour ago, and definitely I will stay in the sport, not as a trainer in a some classic way. I don't have a intention to open a club that people can come to train with me, you know, but I will definitely stay in the sport, because right now I have 3 or 4, maybe 5 good young fighters, you know, and I would like to teach them.
Okay.
I would like to give them part of my experience and to help them as much as I can. That's one part. Second part, definitely I will stay in the sport through the seminars, you know. I will definitely start with my seminars now. And I had so many questions for seminars, but I just didn't have time enough, you know. And I didn't have time to go around, you know, and people who are interested can call me for a seminar, and that's also one of the things I'm going to do. And what else, I don't know. Life is in front of me. I'm still young, maybe not for the professional sport, because to tell the truth, I had enough fights, enough injuries, enough everything, enough body training, enough stress, not just for me, but also for my family. And don't forget, this is a huge stress. Ask people who are getting in your show, you know, professional fighters, how their family are dealing with the stress. It's a really huge stress.
Yeah, I bet.
It's a huge stress, you know. And I think it's only nice things are in front of me, you know.
What are you going to... Sorry, go ahead.
No, I'm finished.
What are you going to miss the most? Is there, like, sometimes you hear fighters say, I'm going to miss the crowds, I'm going to miss the camaraderie with the team, the training, the fight. What are you going to miss the most?
You know what I will miss the most, you know? Training camps.
Ah, really?
Yeah, training camps, usually I had I'm training every day, 365 days a year, but I'm always in a solid shape, unless I'm injured or I have a surgery, you know. And after surgery, I had to make a break for 2 months. I was in the bed, you know, especially when I break my leg, when I break my arm, etc. But if everything is normal, I train every day, you know. And I had a six week training camp. Final stage of preparation, 6 weeks, right? And seventh week was a travel week that I spent in the place where I'm going to fight, you know. And I go all the time. Every time I go 1 week before to get rid of the jet lag, etc. I need to do 3-4 trainings in the town where I'm going to fight, etc. But for this last tournament, I had eight week camp. Plus 1 week, plus 7 weeks, you know. And I will miss it a lot, you know, because my friends are training with me, my coach, Steve, and my sparring partners, you know. We have so many nice moments. We have fun. At least two or three times a week after training, we go for a dinner, you know, and this is so good. We are training very hard, but it is so good, you know. And training in the morning, in the evening, we are having fun, and they're all coming to Zagreb. You know, in my Sasha is from east part of Croatia. Stipe lives on the coast, but they're all coming, you know, and in Zagreb, and then we spend time together. And believe it or not, that's what I'm going to miss the most.
The camaraderie. I know, you know, the being a team and being with your friends and other fighters. Yeah. It definitely means a lot. I have two last quick things for you, and thank you so much for the time once again, especially when you're on a break with your family. What's the happiest moment of your career? Like, do you recall being fighting in a cage in a ring somewhere and you've never felt happier?
I don't know, really. It's hard to say what is the happiest moment. You know, I train hard for every single fight, you know. I left my sweat and my blood on the train for every single fight, you know. For the fights when I win, for the fights when I lose the fight. But I like them all. I like them all. That's part of me. That all of those fights will be part of my life too. And I like them all. And there were so many nice moments, so many happy moments. I was so happy now, especially now in Japan, you know. But I don't say it was the happiest moment in my life, in my career, but one of the happiest, definitely, you know. And especially when I was underdog, I was underdog with the fight with the against King Mo and et cetera, and everything turned well. I trusted myself. I trusted my team. We had a great camp. I believe I can do it. I believe I can do it, you know. And I make it, you know. I did it. And it was a special night for me. December 31st, yeah. In Japan and in Saitama, where I won a Pride Grand Prix Championship. And,
yeah.
It was a really special night. And, yeah.
And you know, you're a special kind of fighter, Mirko, because your fans love you so much and they've been supporting you. And it's like every time you do anything, any kind of news, they're always like, get Mirko on the show. You have a very loyal fan base. You don't need me to tell you this. And so I always get a lot of great reaction and feedback when you're on the show or when we announce that you're going to be on the show. What if anything, would you like to say to those fans who have supported you for the last, you know, almost 20 years?
I'm grateful. I'm aware of it. Huge support I had during my career. Sometimes, believe me, I ask myself, do I deserve it, you know, because I had unbelievable support, especially during my UFC days in the States, you know, and when the audience was booing my opponent, you know, and they were screaming when I enter on the weight scale, when I entering the arena. It was amazing. Especially now, you know, same thing happened now with, for example, with Baruto. Baruto lives for 15 years in Japan, you know, and he speaks Japanese perfectly. And he's a superstar in Japan. But the arena was booing him. Unbelievable. I couldn't believe. I couldn't believe. I don't know if you have seen the fight or if you listen to the crowd, but people were booing him, you know. I couldn't believe, you know, he's at the end of the day, he lives in Japan. He speaks Japanese perfectly, you know, and he's a sumo star. But people were booing him. It was amazing, you know. It was an incredible thing, you know. And I had such a great support during my career. I had such a great, and I'm really grateful to my fans and for the people who supported me during my career. And what else I can say?
Amazing. What a pleasure, I said. Yes.
Of course, I would like to say more things, but unfortunately, my English is a little bit limited.
That's great. Say it in Croatian. All your friends speak Croatian.
No.
Can you No?
It makes no sense. It makes no sense to speak in Croatia. But I had a great time with my fans, and I felt support. Believe me, I felt that support, especially when I'm entering the arena. And now on 31st December, when for the opening ceremony, the whole arena was screaming my name. It was a really special night, and it is a special feeling. And I just want to thank everyone. I just want to thank everyone who was supporting me during my career.
Beautiful. Yeah, I'm sure that you will be thinking about those moments and those chants for a very long time, and it's well-deserved. Again, like I said, it's a privilege, as always, to have you on the show. Congratulations on an incredible Hall of Fame, legendary career, Mirko. What a pleasure, as always, to have you on and to talk about it. And I'm happy to hear that you're still going to remain in the sport because you mean a lot to a lot of people. Congratulations on the Grand Prix win. Congratulations, again, on a tremendous career. And now enjoy some time with your family. Heal up. Get well soon, and hopefully we'll see you at a fight or something in the near future. That would be great.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll talk to you soon.
And a big hug to all people who are listening to this and to all my fans.
Well said. Thank you, Mirko.
Thank you.